Ladies and gentlemen, members and guests, colleagues and friends, I am deeply honored to be chosen for this award. Thank you, Madam President, members of the award committee, and Professor Özlük for his kind introduction. I accept this award on behalf of a large group of scientists, numerous postdocs, graduate students, and undergraduates, research associates, and technicians. I'm grateful to all of them. Some of you are here. And to the many collaborators around the world who contributed to our success. For this brief address, I had to select what to cover, and the microscope in the Allen Award medal inspired me to focus on adventures in cytogenetics. Yeah. Let's start from the beginning. In the German educational system, I majored in math and physics with Latin as a language requirement, so I couldn't speak much English when I came to this country. And in medical school, I thought biochemistry was the most interesting subject. I remember one day the professor walking in all excited, telling us that messenger RNA had been discovered. Now we understand how genetic information is transmitted. Therefore, after my pediatric training, I wanted to subspecialize in endocrinology, a field with some understanding of the role of molecules and pathways in disease processes and rational approaches to treatment. But as a foreign medical graduate, my application was not even considered. But at UCLA, a new fellowship program in pediatric genetics had just been started under Stan Wright, and they gladly accepted me. So I got into genetics at the beginning of a new era, and I have not regretted it for a moment. It allowed me to embark on an unbelievable journey, and I was able to participate in the development of our field for the last 40 years. When I started my fellowship at UCLA, chromosomes were uniformly stained. With a few exceptions, they could not be individually identified. Then one day, Stan came with a big news that Caspersen in Sweden had told him that with a fluorescent dye quinacrine, they could reliably distinguish chromosomes 17 and 18. This was exciting, and I had to try it. I dug up a microscope with a movable mirror looking like the one on the Allen Award medal and a fluorescent lamp, and spent many hours in the dark room identifying each human chromosome, and then the chromosomes involved in translocations in patients that the genetics division had previously collected. When mouse geneticist Muriel Nesbitt joined the faculty, we collaborated on constructing the first quinacrine-stained mouse karyotype. The quinacrine bands are fuzzy, and people asked for densitometry profiles and ideograms. Identifying the mouse chromosomes was a big step for mouse genetics because linkage groups had been associated with abnormal yet unidentified chromosomes. By identifying the mouse chromosomes involved in these translocations, we were able to assign entire linkage groups to their respective physical locations. So I got an early taste for gene mapping and mouse genetics, areas that I continue to pursue. When G-banding became available, we started to make measurements on mouse chromosome bands and constructed these ideograms, taking into account the relative staining intensity of each band. And this resulted in the mouse karyotypes. I drew them in shapes as I saw them in the microscope, and we divided each mouse chromosomes into major regions A, B, C, and then subdivided into numerals. That numbering system became the standard for mouse chromosomes. Meanwhile, the International Committee of Human Cytogenetic Nomenclature had devised a system for human chromosome bands based on impressions, not measurements. And in the mid-1970s, when cell synchronization methods enabled the study of longer prometaphase chromosomes, resulting in high-resolution banding, we started to do measurements in the mouse, in the human chromosomes, as Muriel and I had done in the mouse, and hand-drew ideograms for mouse chromosomes that more accurately represented what we saw in the microscope. Noellen Oliver was a very talented technician in the lab who then went on to become a graduate student in genetics at Stanford and got her PhD with Doug Wallace. So we are all connected. Meanwhile, the high-resolution banding ideograms that the ISCN produced were again arbitrary subdivisions, and the chromosomes didn't look much like what we saw in the microscope. So I decided to revise our ideograms and make them consistent with the numbering system of ISCN. And that involved making some compromises because white bands had to separate dark and gray bands. But this contribution then was published in 1981 together with the official ideograms. Well, to continue the ideogram story, in the early 1990s, the Human Genome Project got underway and people coming from molecular biology and computer science backgrounds were talking about the human genome as a one-dimensional string of four letters, an informational entity whose function they would be able to unravel given enough computing power. I felt they are missing a point, because a single molecule of DNA that runs from one end of the chromatid to the other is packaged into metaphase chromosome in a distinctly uneven pattern. The dark bands condense much earlier than the light bands in the continuous process of pro-metaphase. The bands must reflect some underlying biology. So I had the ideograms professionally redrawn and published them together with the underlying measurements to point out, to make a contribution that, to point out that chromosome banding information could make a contribution to the Human Genome Project. And I pointed out their features and their uses. So this paper is not available online, but the ideograms are used in many illustrations, textbooks, databases, commercial products, and nobody remembers where they came from. This is the underlying map of the GWAS catalog, even as a circle after telomere fusion. While this makes me proud, but I know there are imperfections, would there be any reason to repeat the work using better quality chromosomes now? This is data from the 1970s. Well, about 3 years ago, a paper was published in Science on genome-wide chromatin conformation analysis assessing the physical proximity of DNA segments. And they were able to compartmentalize the genome into two different types of interaction. Some areas of the genome where DNA segments interact very closely and others where they don't. And this coincides the compartmentalization. How do I do this here? Shown here as the eigenvectors, coincides in some way with gene density, chromatin modification, and DNase-1 hypersensitivity. So this is interface. When I saw this pattern, I immediately recognized that I had seen this before because it lined up with our ideograms. So the closed segments correspond to dark bands and the open segments to light bands. And this would mean that in fact, that the chromatin organization and packaging that is present in interface is carried over to metaphase and is reflected in the banding patterns. I was thrilled. I made these slides and told my undergraduate class the next morning. But the lineup did not work perfectly for all chromosomes. And last year, finally, I met Dr. Aidan Liebermann and told him about my hypothesis, and he is now actively working on testing it. So one reason to make chromosome maps is to place genes onto the map. Back in history, after my year of fellowship at UCLA, we moved to San Diego, and I started to work in Bill Nyhan's lab learning biochemical genetics and developed a carrier test for Lesch-Nyhan syndrome using hair root lysate electrophoresis. And then when Jerry Schneider returned from a sabbatical in Paris and brought back the somatic cell fusion technology, I had an idea for a doable project. I proposed to regionally map genes on chromosomes by fusing human cells carrying a translocation to a mouse or Chinese hamster cell line. Human chromosomes are randomly lost from such hybrid cells, and being able to identify human and rodent chromosomes by banding and to separate human and rodent isozymes by gel electrophoresis, I could assign species-specific cellular phenotypes to defined chromosome regions. I applied for an R01, and the study section was in favor. They even recommended a budget increase so I could buy the best size microscope on the market. And funding was contingent upon UCSD giving me a faculty position, so I became an assistant professor in residence in pediatrics. Initially, the phenotypes we could map in somatic cell hybrids were limited to expressed proteins, where the human-specific forms could be distinguished from the rodent forms. Like in this example, there is a translocation between chromosomes 1 and 6, and by mapping human HLA to the distal part and PGM3 to the proximal part, and knowing that the two were 15 centimorgans apart on the linkage map, we lined up the linkage map with the physical map and predicted the locations of these genes. With the advent of molecular probes, we were able to map hybridizing fragments on southern blots. In collaboration with Ray White and David Botstein, we mapped the first highly polymorphic human RFLP locus to a region of chromosome 14 and discovered the first molecularly defined locus present on both the X and Y chromosome, DXYS1. Besides mapping human genes, we also used DNA from somatic cell hybrid between Chinese hamster and mouse cells that segregated mouse chromosomes to map the same genes to mouse chromosomes. In this fashion, we contributed to the recognition and definition of conserved syntenic regions in these species. With molecular probes in hand, we also used in situ hybridization of labeled probes directly to banded chromosomes. This independent approach enabled us to confirm and further refine the regional map positions. Initially, small probes were tritium-labeled and other radiographic grains were counted. This is assignment of synapsin 1 to the X chromosome and a region of the X on hybrid basis with in situ hybridization confirming it, the mouse X chromosome. And so this allowed the lineup of the mouse and the human X and comparing their evolution. In the 1980s, then, radioactively labeled cDNA was replaced by fluorescently labeled cosmid probes with hybridization signals detected in a fluorescent microscope. With our reliable gene mapping tools, we had the great fortune to collaborate with the premier cloning labs and mapped a large number of important genes as they were being cloned, and thus we contributed to the human and mouse physical maps. But our real motivation was to find disease genes. We were hoping to map a gene to a location that coincided with a previously mapped disease locus or mouse mutant phenotype, and thus help to identify the disease-causing gene. That kind of hit occurred rarely, though. We tested many positional candidate genes in DNA samples from affected individuals or mutant mouse strains, usually with negative results. So synapsin 1 was not mutated in Rett syndrome. With the exception of some successes here, the peripheral myelin protein gene 22 coincided with the location of the Trembler mutation in the mouse and Charcot-Marie-Tooth in the human and was found to be mutated in these diseases. For finding disease genes, there is yet another cytogenetic approach. Disease genes can be localized or even identified if the disease phenotype is associated with a chromosome aberration that's visible in the microscope. A tiny deletion may remove the relevant locus, or a translocation may disrupt it. This approach started with a little girl who had sporadic bilateral retinoblastoma, and we found an interstitial deletion of chromosome 13. Comparing this case and scattered literature report allowed me to predict the location of the retinoblastoma gene in 13Q14, information that was later confirmed when the gene was cloned and in fact assisted in the cloning of the gene. In a similar fashion, aniridia and Wilms tumor were known to segregate as autosomal dominant traits. Discovery of a microdeletion on 11P placed both loci in this region. Then in 1984, a blood sample and LCL from this boy was sent to us by Hans-Dieter Ox in Seattle. He was affected with four different X-linked diseases. He had been studied by several specialists, but no genetic abnormalities had been detected. And you wonder what's maybe wrong with his X chromosome. We saw a deletion in XP21. This dark band that normally splits into two never split in this patient's DNA, so the white band was missing. But we needed a molecular probe to prove that this was real, because if the missing material had been inserted somewhere else, we would not see that. We obtained XP probes from collaborators, and there were very few at the time, and none were missing in patient BB. Therefore, we made somatic cell hybrids with the Chinese hamster cell line and isolated his X chromosome from all his other chromosomes. Ultimately, one probe from Peter Pearson's lab in the Netherlands was deleted from his X chromosome and his total DNA, proving that indeed he had a deletion. Cells from this patient were used by Lou Kunkel to isolate DNA fragments from the deletion and subsequently by Roya Pokora to clone the gene for chronic granulomatous disease, the first human disease gene cloned on the basis of its location, with no prior knowledge of its function. We went on to identify additional patients with overlapping XP2-1 deletions and various phenotypes that allowed the mapping and ordering of disease genes. So to stay focused on this agenda, I'm skipping over many projects with Scott Aldrich, Rett, Marfan, Laron, Robert syndrome. The next challenge in cytogenetics was the dissection of microdeletion syndromes. First, we needed to find all the genes in the deletion and then ask which of the many deletions are responsible for which of the phenotypes. The deletion syndromes we focused on, Williams-Boyron syndrome and Prader-Willi syndrome, are caused by non-allelic homologous recombination between flanking repeats, and therefore the same set of genes are deleted in most patients. Williams-Boyron syndrome, a well-known clinical condition with a unique neurobehavioral features, is caused by a barely visible deletion on 7q11.23, where the elastin gene is located. Some of the light material is missing, so in the deleted chromosome, the gray band is now in the middle. And in order to find genes in the deletion, before the first draft of the human genome became available, my lab made a quantic clone map by screening bug libraries and sequencing the end. And we identified several new genes in the deletion shown marked here. We knocked one out in the mouse, Frizzled-9, but the mouse didn't have much of a phenotype. So we decided to make a mouse model for the deletion. But rather than the mouse region of in the mouse homologous to this region of chromosome 7 is on mouse chromosome 5, and the entire region is conserved with the genes in the same order but inverted with respect to the centromere, and the mouse doesn't have the flanking repeats. So rather than taking out the entire region from the mouse, we decided to make two half deletions that then the proximal and the distal deletion, and if those heterozygotes are bred together, we get all four genotypes in the same litter, where the double heterozygote represents the full Williams syndrome deletion. And these mice can be studied and compared. We have access to brain tissue. And this was a huge effort over many years. Many people in the lab contributed, and the results are in this paper in the inaugural journal of issue of a new journal, Embryomolecular Medicine. The mice were found to reproduce some features of Williams syndrome, for example, hypersociability, that could be assigned to one or the other half of the deletion, and the details are all in this paper. In the case of Prader-Willi syndrome, the deletion involves an imprinted region, and genes that are deleted or non-functional are on the paternally inherited chromosome, and the maternal copies are silent. This project started in our lab in 1992 with the assignment of the first protein coding gene, SNRPN, to the deleted region. We then systematically looked for other genes and found various non-coding RNAs and a cluster of small nuclear RNA genes, snRNAs, located in introns. To delineate the minimal responsible region, we studied reciprocal translocation cases by mapping the breakpoints, and taking our data together with other data in the literature led us to propose that a small region between SNRPN and UBE3A containing the snRNA cluster discovered in our lab and independently by Hüttenhofer in Germany now named SNORT-116, was responsible for the Prader-Willi phenotype. To test this hypothesis, Fang Ding took on the arduous task to make a mouse model deleted for just this cluster of chromosome of SNORNAs by chromosome engineering in ES cells. In contrast to previous Prader-Willi mouse models, the SNORT-116 deletion mice are viable, and extensive metabolic, dietary, and behavioral studies of these mice revealed some Prader-Willi-like features, such as growth delay and hyperphagia, but lacked others. The mice are not hypotonic, and they do not get obese. Then, surprisingly, Art Baudet's lab and others reported human patients meeting criteria for Prader-Willi syndrome diagnosis with deletions of just these SNORNAs. How the lack of these SNORNAs produces the phenotype is a fascinating question. The answer involves finding out the normal role of these CD-box SNORNAs. We know they do not modify ribosomal RNAs, as most known SNORNAs of this type do. They may be involved in regulating alternative splicing or messenger RNA or RNA editing. When I closed my lab, Dr. Ding went back to China and continues to study these mice. We also deposited them at the Jackson Lab to be available for any researcher who wants to tackle these questions. Allow me to make a few final comments. The last time this society met here was 13 years ago, and I served as president. In my presidential address entitled Human Genetics in the Information Age, I strongly advocated for open access publishing online. And we now know that about 17% of all articles are published in open access journals with biomedicine leading. I also predicted that medical genetic services will be provided online. I said there was a huge need to provide online genetic information tailored to consumers that is accurate, up-to-date, and accessible. There should be career opportunities for site developers and database curators. And I have no doubt that interactive web-based systems will be developed that can provide accurate, timely, and individualized genetic information. In 2007, when Ann Wojcicki and Linda Evers had started 23andMe, the personal genomics company, and invited me to serve as a consultant for the editorial team, I accepted, knowing that this was the direction I wanted to go in. And in 2010, I joined the company as a part-time employee. Working with the company's research team opened new opportunities for a different kind of research that is participant-driven, bottom-up. With a rapidly growing database of more than 180,000 people genotyped for 1 million SNPs, and most of these people participating in research by providing self-reported phenotypes, we are able to quickly replicate published GWAS and discover novel associations, GWAS and FIVAS, and as evidenced by nearly 20 abstracts the team submitted to this meeting. In response to the controversy about DTC genetic testing, we decided to implement an interview-based study on consumer reactions to BRCA test results. We only test for the two BRCA1 and one BRCA2 mutations that are common in Ashkenazim and convey a high risk of breast and ovarian cancer. What do people do with the unexpected information that they carry such a mutation? Here are the major results in a nutshell, and for more information, you can go to the poster. But people don't freak out. They do see their doctor. They have their family members tested. Overall, it's a very positive result. All but one said they were happy to know the information after all. So lastly, based on what I learned, what advice would I give to young people who are just starting out in human genetics? One is to acquire skills and knowledge in several areas. Look for intriguing and important open questions that can be answered by combining skills and approaches. Learn how to extract information from rapidly growing databases. This is obvious. You can see at this meeting that this is what most people are doing now. But also choose your collaborators wisely to complement your own skills and knowledge and treat them with respect. I have seen my share of bench scientists who look at physicians as just providers of samples, or physicians who think of laboratory scientists as DNA jocks. We can learn so much from each other. And if you are a physician scientist, learn from your patients. The road between the clinic and the lab is a two-way street. You want to have an anchor in both to be most productive. So I would like to thank many people, mentors, collaborators, and all the people who worked in my lab, and the funders, and the society for giving me this award, and you all for listening. Thank you.
Everyone here wrote this.